What's going on, everybody, and welcome back to another video. Ever since I got back from my honeymoon last year in England and Scotland, I have been desperately craving good cask ale, and there's just simply nowhere around here that does it, quite like the English pubs do. So I decided to take matters into my own hands and build a system for myself. Before we get too far into the video, I want to give credit where credit is due and call out Dudes Brews, another YouTube channel out there from England, where I got most of the information I needed to set this system up from one of his videos. Also, Clawhammer Supply has done something very similar, so check out their video as well. We're going to talk about getting the true cask experience at home, but also we're going to talk about how to set this up and attach it to a keg and use the keg as kind of a pseudo cask, but I'll get more into the details on that shortly. This beer engine here is by far the most expensive part of the entire system. Luckily, these things actually pop up a lot on the used market, and you can find them for a lot less expensive than they are brand new. So that's how I got mine. I'm gonna link this model brand new down in the description box, but be on the lookout on eBay and other places. You can find these without too much effort. Before we jump into the building part of this whole thing, I wanna talk about cask really quickly, and why is it special? Why do people in England, Ireland, and Scotland treat it almost like a religion in some cases? To understand cask ale truly, we have to really back up and go back into history. It's an old method of serving beer. It comes from, well, really the oldest roots of English brewing traditions. And beer used to be made back in the day before refrigeration, before any sort of fancy techniques. It was really brewed and put into these wooden casks and shipped to the pubs. And it would have been either tapped directly from the cask and poured into a glass from gravity, or it would have been pulled up from the cask using one of these hand pumps, which is literally just a sanitary insulated pneumatic pump, which would pull the beer out of the cask and put it in your glass. Contrast this now with the more common kegging system, which uses CO2 and gas to push highly carbonated beer out of a keg. The benefit of the kegging system, of course, being that you can serve beer that is not going to go bad quickly. You can leave it in your keg, it's only getting CO2 exposure, it's not getting oxygen exposure. Anytime you're using a cask in the traditional way, you're pulling oxygen in every time you pour a glass of beer just due to that vacuum. This used to be controlled by use of a wooden spile that would be driven into the bung in the cask. This would slow down the ingress of oxygen and would keep the beer fresher a bit longer, but generally cask ale is only going to be good for a few days. So breweries will take this beer, they will put it into modern day casks, which are actually like steel barrels essentially, but they're set up the same way old casks were. I digress, but they will package this beer extremely fresh, and they will oftentimes package it before the fermentation is complete, or they will prime the keg as if it was a bottle, and that results in a beer that's still actively fermenting when it gets to the pub. The reason why cask ale is such a big deal is because it's really the freshest possible version of beer, outside of pouring it directly off of your fermenter. So you're getting the best expression of flavors, you're getting the way that, in most cases in England at least, the way the beer was designed to be consumed and the way it was designed by the brewer. This lighter carbonation state allows a lot more of the flavors in, especially English style ales, to express themselves. And you get this really, really rich flavor character and a very rich mouthfeel as well. It's really hard to describe the reason why it's such a good way to serve beer. The closest thing I can really equate it to is a nitro pour, which is, I'd say, about 70% of the effect that you get out of a true cask pour. But there is a difference, and it is a really, really interesting thing. And the reason why I'm building a cask system for myself and giving you the instructions to do so is because I think it's worth exploring as a home brewer. You're getting, especially if you brew an English style ale, you're getting something incredibly special and incredibly fresh that you can only find in very select circumstances. The way that English, Irish, and Scottish yeasts and hops and malts kind of work together in a cask ale is a very special thing, and it's very hard to describe the effects that you get from serving it on cask versus serving it on CO2 or even nitro. One really just has to experience it to get the full effect. And I hate saying that because it feels like a cop-out, but it is something that's truly an X factor. Now, there certainly are some challenges involved in serving this kind of beer because you have that inevitable oxygen exposure. So oxygen leads to staling of beer relatively quickly. In a good cellar where the cask ale is taken care of properly, you can get these beers to last for 1 to 2 weeks on cask. And that's absolutely no problem in a situation like a pub where there's a lot of turnaround of beer and you're really getting through them pretty quickly. The shelf life of these beers can slightly be extended by using a device known as a cask breather, which is a system that allows atmospheric pressure of CO2 to go in and basically provide a little bit more shelf life on the order of a couple weeks to a cask. At the homebrew scale, that oxidation really does present a bit of a challenge. Most of us, I think, are not going to be burning through 5 gallons of cask ale in a week or two. So the immediate solution is to brew smaller batches or use smaller containers, and that's where my idea for this whole thing got started. Homebrew scale casks exist. There's a 5 gallon firkin that you can purchase if you wish to do it on a 5 gallon scale, but I don't recommend it. For me, 5 gallons is a bit excessive for 1 to 2 weeks of shelf life. For my personal situation, a 1 gallon size makes a lot more sense for the shelf life of a cask ale, a real cask ale with oxygen coming in and not CO2. So the way I'm gonna do this is I'm gonna hook up a Northern Brewer mini keg. They have a 1 gallon sized mini keg, which has corny disconnects in it. And this will allow me to simulate a cask. So my plan here is to build this beer engine, which you'll see in a minute, and then we're gonna brew up an English pale ale, specifically like a Yorkshire style best bitter. And we're going to put 1 gallon of that into the 1 gallon mini cask, basically. I'm gonna prime it and condition it to cask levels of carbonation, which is like 1 to 1.5 volumes of CO2. And we'll hook it up to the beer engine as soon as it's ready and fresh. And I'm really excited to see how it turns out. The other 4 gallons of the beer is gonna go into a regular corny keg, and that will be also keg conditioned, and I'm gonna hook that up to a cask breather with a CO2 attachment so that I can still kind of extend the shelf life of the 4 gallons. I think that might work. If it doesn't, we'll let you know. There will be a grain of glass for the English pale ale. That video will come out later. But if you're watching this a few weeks in the future, you can go ahead and check out the card notification that'll pop up in the corner where I show you that particular brew. But in the meantime, let's go ahead and get this beer engine built. So I got this wooden platform for it, which is nice, but I had to build a little bit of a shelf for it to stick on because I'm gonna have tubing that runs underneath of it and goes to the cask that I'm using. So that's why this is like this, but it also allows me to get up in there. So the way this thing works essentially is there's this little cylinder in here, which in this case is a 1/4 pint cylinder. And what that does is it actually fills up with beer and gets compressed by the pump, which then pushes it out after a second pump. And it's actually an interesting little design, but it's basically just a pneumatic pump. So now I've got the hose hooked up here on the inside, and that's gonna be what eventually leads to our cask. At first, I gotta put the front plate back on. So the beer engine's pretty much assembled. We have our line that comes out from the bottom underneath the pump, and that has to make its way onto the keg. Here, I have a keg of sanitizer. So quite simply, we have our liquid side tubing here, which is now gonna get hooked up to something very, very important. This is a check valve. What this means is, especially if you're serving your cask style beer out of a pressurized keg or something that's higher up in elevation than the beer pump, what you need is a check valve, and this basically prevents that pressure coming from this side of the house from hitting the beer engine and basically forcing itself out of the spout while you're not using it. Very simple, nice quick disconnects fittings here, so that's nice and tight. And just like that, our dispensing system is actually complete. Now, if there is beer in this, you could actually serve it as is. It will push this poppet valve down on the inside, which will actually let that oxygen in and allow you to have that cask experience. But we are gonna sanitize the whole system first. And the easiest way to do that is just to use a keg of sanitizer with nothing on this side. If you want the flow to be a bit easier, you can always pop open the pressure relief valve and that'll release some of the tension and the strain on the system. But first, let's sanitize this. There's gonna be nothing but air for the first bit, so you have to pump a couple times. But it fills the cylinder, and now you'll see the liquid starting to pull itself through the line here. And now, the vacuum's been created. It's time to get ourselves some sanitizer. Now, typically, you're gonna immerse the tip into the glass to minimize the amount of foaming. It's pretty stiff resistance, but there is some nice sanitizer on cask. And that's really all there is to it. So what I'm gonna be doing is that exact same system is gonna go on my 1 gallon mini keg for a true simulated cask experience. Now, if you wanna do this with a full 5 gallon keg and have it last a lot longer, you need a couple other pieces of hardware and you need to set it up on the gas side. So we'll talk about that now. All right, what I'm showing here is called a cask breather. Effectively, what this is a device that sits between a CO2 tank and your keg. Basically, what it does is allow for CO2 to be backfilled into the keg or cask, whatever you're serving from, instead of just straight up air. The CO2 is only added at atmospheric pressure and not any higher, although your CO2 tank has to be hooked up to the cask breather at about 5 PSI. So basically every time you pull a pint out of your cask using the beer engine, it's gonna replace that spent volume with CO2 at atmospheric pressure and prevent the beer from staling as quickly as it otherwise would, which allows you to get about an extra couple weeks on your cask. Now, one last item that Dude's Brews really recommends doing, and I also concur with this, is putting a drain valve on your cask system. As soon as you pour a beer, you have a lot of beer that's in this line and also in that cylinder, which is the next beer to be poured. And if you're not taking a cask pour for a long time, it's going to go stale, it's going to go bad. So ideally, you drain that out and have that as like a second pint or something if you're not using the system for a while. And also just keeps everything a little bit more sanitary. So the easiest way to do this is really to simply put a Y connection in along with a ball valve so that you can drain things out very quickly. And that's really all there is to it. So now any liquid that builds up in here in this Y connection can get drained out simply either into a beer glass if you wish or into a dump bucket of some kind. So just to give everybody a picture of how this whole thing is set up real quickly, I'm just gonna go over every piece of it for both the gas side and the liquid side. So starting with the gas side, it's not hooked up to anything because I'm running off of my simulated cask, which doesn't have any CO2 input to it. However, if I was to hook up to a keg or something that had CO2 on the opposite side, that's where this would come in. So it starts with this carbonation cap right here, which is just an easy way for me to hook up my CO2 tank. That has a barb on the back of it that goes to this quarter inch line here, which then has a quarter inch to half inch John Guest fitting. That is an half inch OD tubing, which is just what I had available, but also what fits on this cask breather here. You want the arrow pointing down. I'm not sure why exactly that is, but it is very important to have it mounted in a particular orientation according to the instructions. On the opposite side of the cask breather, we have another little bit of half inch tubing, another John Guest fitting going back to quarter inch so that I can use my regular gas side disconnect, which is what I would hook up on the keg that I'd be simulating a cask with. For the liquid side, I have a line going into my fermentation chamber, which I have set up to 55 degrees right now. That's hooked up to a cask slash keg. This line then goes into the check valve here, which prevents me from having any sort of pressurized beer moving past this valve and up into the beer engine. So this line is actually empty right now. This is the half inch ID line. So I think it's a 5/8 inch OD that goes up into the actual beer engine. It goes from that check valve to the Y connection first with the drain valve on it. This is the only place where this sort of drain valve will work, between the check valve and the actual beer engine. So just if you're setting it up this way, make sure that's how you have it oriented. It's in the closed position now. If it's in the open position, it'll drain all the beer in the line. And then that line finally goes up underneath into the beer engine where it will serve beer. So I've gone ahead and brewed the Yorkshire style bitter that I wanted to use to test out this system. So I kegged this up and conditioned it in the keg as if it was a cask, primed to that 1.5 volumes of CO2. As soon as I had finished conditioning, I vented the pressure out of it and I hooked up the beer engine and I've got the cylinder full of beer. So now we're gonna find out, as I pour my first pint of this off of the beer engine, did this all work? And was it all worth it? So let's go ahead, zoom you in to the beer engine so we got a good visual on this, and let's get this thing poured. Look at that cascade. Oh my goodness, this is really what it looks like. Nice frothy head on that. It is not exactly perfectly clear. So I'm sorry that camera's gonna be a bit upset about that, but it's getting close. I mean, you can sort of see it. I think that'll probably come with a bit more time conditioning at 55 degrees. Look at that, that was a really nice color. I'm really happy with that. And that's a nice, persistent, really rich, tight bubbles on the head there. Little bit of residual haze, but nothing too crazy. Oh, wow. That tastes and feels just like a real cask ale. It's that soft, light mouthfeel, really rich malt character. And yeah, a little bit of carbonation, but nothing too crazy. And yeah, it just gets that mouthfeel perfect. This is it, man. This is real cask ale in my basement. Holy crap, that's amazing. You just cannot beat the drinkability of this either. And wow. So I'm gonna save the tasting notes for this bad boy until the actual grain to glass video comes out, which shouldn't be too long from now, maybe a week or so. And then you'll see exactly how it turned out, but I can tell you right now, it did turn out pretty good, and serving this on cask is awesome. You cannot beat that. So if you're looking to build this system for yourself and you want to copy this whole process, I've linked all of the pieces of equipment that I used down in the description box for your convenience. So hopefully that makes it much easier when it comes time to build your own system. And I hope it works out just as well for you as it did for me. Beer engine or not, serving real ale is actually a really, really interesting thing and a good nod to history. And I encourage homebrewers to try something like this. It's absolutely doable, as you can see. You know, even without building a contraption like this, you can still do it with a keg that's been mounted horizontally that you're pouring out via gravity. It's possible to do stuff like that. There's plenty of information out there on the internet about it, so do some research. Let me know if you have questions and I'll try to help you out as best I can. I really hope that I can continue to spread the love for this tradition that's kind of dying out. I hope that by doing my part to keep it alive, I've interested you enough to try it out yourself. And at the very least, if you ever find yourself in England, Ireland, or Scotland, and you see one of these hand pumps, get the beer that's on that hand pump, because it's going to be worth it. All right. Well, anyway, guys, thank you so much for watching, and I hope you really found this video useful and were able to use it to your own benefit. If the video was useful, please do me a favor, just hit that like button and subscribe if you haven't already. You're really going to want to make sure you subscribe so you can actually see the grain of glass video for this particular brew, which is going to go hand in hand with this video. Comment down below with your thoughts and everything. Let me know if you've tried something like this at home. If you have any sort of aspirations to do cask ale at home, let me know. If you want to support the channel, please consider checking out the merchandise store where you can get this particular shirt, which I thought was very fitting for this piece of equipment here. There's plenty of other designs out there as well in the store though, and I get about 30% of the sticker price off of them. So it means a lot when you can purchase a t-shirt, you get something out of it, I get something out of it, we all profit, we all win. I also have a Patreon, and my Patreon supporters have really helped a ton in upgrading the production quality of this channel. Not only have they helped purchase new equipment, but also they're helping to fund projects like this. And so I really do owe a lot to my Patreon supporters because you guys are helping drive new, interesting, and engaging content. And I really appreciate your support for that. Otherwise, I also have the channel memberships option and the Super Thanks button. If you want to hit either of those, all of that's greatly appreciated. I also have an Amazon store where you can find all of the homebrewing equipment and the camera equipment and stuff like that that I recommend that's on Amazon. If I've used it and I feel like it's good stuff, I will put it on those lists so you can check them out and buy with confidence, I suppose. If you want to follow me on more than just YouTube, I'm also active on Instagram and Facebook as The Apartment Brewer. So check those links out as well for some future looks into what might be coming to the channel soon. This particular item was previewed on Instagram, so it's well worth it if you want to see what's coming to the channel to follow me on Instagram. Last and certainly not least, if you're still here, thank you very, very much for watching all the way to the end of the video. I do put a ton of work into these things, and it means a lot that you are still here. So until the next one, cheers.